some dollars.
Nancy Hartsock's work on feminist standpoint theory, Donna Haraway's work on situated knowledges, and David Harvey's work on questions or critiques of idealism and other sort of dematerialized forms of contemporary thinking, all in one way or another contact each including what gets to count as materiality in the first place. So that's the topic of knowledge. Another topic of alliances, what I wanted to point out, and this is my final introduction, is that these three scholars are also three friends. They first met each other in Baltimore at Johns Hopkins University in a Marxist reading group. And that quirky kind of beginning now I'm using some material that they gave me last night over dinner. Owed something, it seems, to the rather elitist and difficult situation Johns Hopkins provided for faculty engaged in radical kinds of scholarship. And that provided the necessity and the possibility of them coming together, it seems. But equally, David suggested that it was indicative, that quirky beginning, of the more general quirkiness to be found in the city of Baltimore. And he told us that he and someone, a photographer friend, had playfully talked about a new book idea on Baltimore that might be called The City of Quirks, ripping off the title of Mike Davis's book, The City of Quarks. And Donna suggested that this is a very good idea for a book project, and he's quite serious about it. And Nancy, I think, suggested that it was also a good way to introduce them. Not as the three tenors, but three friends, three scholars, Haraway, Harvey, and Hartsock from the City of Quirks.
Developing with discovering a pre-existing external something, which if it meets some criteria, it can be labeled as true. Moreover, it must be discovered from nowhere in particular, so that truth can retain its pristine qualities, what Donna has called the God trick. But the definition of truth that I want to rely on is more complex than this, and is heavily indebted to my own reading of Marx. In the thesis on Feuerbach, Marx talks about the importance of not thinking about things or objects, especially, as he says, objects of contemplation, and makes the point, man must prove the truth, that is, the reality and power, the this-worldliness of his thinking and practice. And I think this really changes the criteria for what can count as knowledge. If truth is the reality and power of our ideas in action, then we must treat knowledge and truth in much more historically specific ways and devote attention to the social and historical and ultimately conventional form of all definitions of truth. We should remember that the search for knowledge is, after all, a human activity. But here, as you can see, I become very uncomfortable with the language of truth. And maybe a better concept to use would be that of certitude, a sense that one has credible knowledge, knowledge that is at least good enough to act on. The point, I think, of this knowledge is to understand power relations, and the point of understanding these relations is, of course, to change them. Now, one of the things that I think makes the I think one of the other things that we need to note is that the categories and criteria for judging truth, those which come most immediately to mind, are likely to be those of the dominant groups. So Marx, for example, would argue that everything appeared reversed in competition, that is, from the perspective of the market. That the accumulation of wealth and capitalism is at the same time the accumulation of misery. Yet these categories and criteria are made true for all members of society. One can think of a number of examples such as this. Compulsory heterosexuality, for example, enforced as a truth, that is made real through a variety of practices and sanctions. Or in other contexts, I've noted the phenomenon of inversion. And Eduardo Galeano, writing in the context of a military government in Argentina, has said some very enlightening things. He says, freedom in my country is the name of a jail for political prisoners. And democracy is part of the title of regimes of terror around the world. So truth, I think, is a problematic category. And later I want to suggest a redefinition. Well, second, the nature of subjects and their position, their possibilities for agency. And here, in contrast to the American tendency, sometimes with the help of some European post-structuralists themselves, the tendency to interpret post-structuralism in liberal pluralist terms, or even, sometimes, libertarian terms, these terms really rely on microprocesses of power. And what I want to suggest is that we need to focus on the macro processes of power, which, although they get played out in individual lives, can only be fully understood at the level of society as a whole. So to claim, I think, that we can understand the totality of social relations from an individual perspective is as futile an effort as to claim that we could see everything from nowhere. But I think a focus on these large-scale social forces really highlights different aspects of subjectivity. And I want to just briefly comment on two of them. One, it's really groups which are the important subjects, that is, collective subjects. And second, what I want to do is to think about the ways the experiences of marginality construct groups differently, construct subjectivity differently. If people in the back row at some point can't hear, would you wave at me? So, the subjects that matter are collective subjects. These are groups, but groups are not formed unproblematically, and therefore come to see the world in a particular way. I think, in fact, what's interesting is that groups are formed by two contradictory dynamics. One, there's enforced membership, enforced by the Donna Group. And second, there's group membership constructed through political struggle. And what I want to suggest is that social location can increase possibilities for understanding things that for dominant groups are obscure. I want to be sure to say that this process is never an easy one. It's always contingent and fragile. It's a reconstruction and transformation of projects. And as one author put it, the project of transforming subject positions into standpoints involves an active intervention and a conscious effort to reinterpret and restructure our lives. So my second point, the importance of margins. Margins are uncomfortable and sometimes very dangerous places to be, but I think they can be potentially useful places, and that the experience of marginalization can provide important resources as well as motivations for change. And an analysis of how the margins are constituted can really help to create collective subjects as agents of change. So here I want to, in some sense, probably just remind you of three fairly obvious points. One, in understanding marginality, power is central to the construction of social structures. Second, I want to remind you that the margins are inhabited by deviant subjectivities, that is, marked subjectivities, and that these experiences open some possibilities for understanding the world in multiple ways, and possibilities for being more sensitive to power relations. And finally, I think this experience can lead to the formation of counter-hegemonic discourses. So let me expand very briefly on those. I don't want to suggest that those who inhabit the margins are more moral or better people. I think the experience of domination and marginalization leaves many scars, but I do want to suggest that they may open a possibility for important new understandings. So, first, discussions of marginality must recognize that power is central to constituting the marginalized. The margins are distanced from the center, but there are important effects of power, so that the view from the margins is also the view from below. It's also the case that those who are dominated live in a world structured by others for their own purposes. Purposes which, at the very least, are not our own and may be very hostile to our development and even existence. So I think discussions of marginality must address the question of who has the power to determine what is to be the center and what is not. So issues of power, I think, are important. Second, the construction of subjectivities which are different, which are marked, which are deviant in some sense from the norm. I've never really found a better account of this than Albert Mimi's account in The Colonizer and the Colonized. It's the colonizer who constructs the image of the colonized and then imposes this image in every institution and every human contact. So the colonized and the marginalized cannot remain indifferent because power is at work. And as Mimi says, as an end, in the colonizer's supreme ambition, the other should exist only as a function of the needs of the colonizer. So marked subjectivities must be understood as subjected. And part of their subjection is that they are not seen as fellow individual members of a human community, but rather as part of a chaotic, disorganized, and anonymous collectivity. The next point about subjectivities is the importance of inhabiting multiple realities. And Du Bois got it right a long time ago when he talked about the importance of double consciousness. And I can cite a number of other examples briefly to talk about Michelle Cliff, who writes about trying to repossess her African side. Michelle Cliff is a light-skinned Jamaican woman. Or Gloria Anzaldúa in her work on borderlands and the importance of borders. One might also, someone else actually has suggested that Gabriel Garcia Marquez's magical realism was an effort to construct a new way of seeing the world. So, finally, it looks like I'm gonna make my 15 minutes. Finally, the question of privileged knowledge. This is the claim that has gotten me in the most trouble, I think, of anything I've ever written. Maybe it's because of the pluralist tradition in the US. But it seems to me that in some sense, it's the intertwining of issues of politics on the one hand, with, on the other hand, more traditional philosophical questions concerning truth and knowledge. And these, I think, are also combined with conflicting criteria for epistemological validity. But still, I think I prefer to see the controversies over privileged knowledge as a kind of fertile terrain for debates. So fundamentally, what I would argue is that the criteria for privileging some knowledges over others are ethical and political, as well as purely, quotations, epistemological. And I want to suggest that views from the margins, or views from below, are both better and more clear-sighted. Now, Marx had argued that by adopting the standpoint of the working class, or of production, the dynamics of capitalist society could be much more fully understood. Thus, not just the supposedly neutral workings of the free market, but the social relations of production get brought into play. So the market then becomes just one of several factors. Second, I think we need to argue for the privilege of some knowledges over others on the ground that they offer possibilities for the development of more human-friendly and freedom-friendly projects. Third, there's a third aspect to my argument that some knowledges are better than others. And here I think Sheila Sandoval has talked about the ways one can use situated knowledges for the self-conscious transformation of individuals into resistant, oppositional, and collective subjects. In the current context, of course, in the globalization of markets in gendered and raced ways, I think the development of oppositional and collective subjects can only be a very complicated series of tasks. But to return more explicitly to the process by which consciousness is changed or experience reinterpreted, I think it's worth remembering once again that the vision of the ruling groups structures the material relations in which all parties are forced to participate. Thus, the understanding of the oppressed really does have to be struggled for. And in this context, one of the things that I might suggest is that we redefine truth as that which the dominant groups make true. I would be more comfortable with that. So I see Cliff and Ansel Dua and others as developing a kind of privileged knowledge which takes nothing of the dominant culture as self-evidently true. The privileged knowledge is really earned by means of the struggle to overcome what the dominant culture tells us about the world and about ourselves. It comes from the struggle to construct and live in a political community. Thank you.
She's gotten in trouble over that from the point of view of explicit political debate and debate with about the epistemology of the social sciences and of social critique. The trouble I've gotten into has been over much the same point, but within the ecology of the natural sciences, where the question that where the argument that knowledge is made but not made up is very quickly turned into a relativist position in a kind of quasi-libertarian epistemology, that no knowledge is any better than any others, and the natural sciences are matters of opinion or matters of some kind of raw historical relativism, so that it doesn't matter if you can come up with an adequate account of the chemical periodical table of the elements, or any other, which I believe is, among other things, a technology for situating us in a particular kinship group. I think of this as kind of a very fortunate family statement. Among other things, if you would notice the place for plutonium over there, you'll know something about the conditions of globalization and the circulation of the elements, and realize that theory is never merely ideas, but is strongly embodied, including in hacked lives of entities that were indeed made on a squash court at the University of Chicago in the early years of World War II, and had not previously been made in this solar system. And it certainly changes the materiality of our relationships at every level of our being as material semiotic entities. Now let me shift from plutonium, however, to Vancouver Island and the Clackwood Sound, the west coast of Vancouver Island, and to the forestry issues of Vancouver Island, and to the struggle for a community forestry, and indeed not just forestry, for a community ecology that takes account of the marine and forest ecosystems and the many peoples that live in this region of the world. And let me see some of the struggles in Vancouver Island and the Clackwood Sound in particular as a kind of microcosm of the issues that we're trying to sort out. Now, as everyone in this room knows, hybrid knowledges, borderland knowledges, fused differential knowledges are supposed to be particularly high status knowledges these days. And one of the liberal misreadings of the argument that valuable knowledges are struggled for and it takes, you know, feeding and caring for them to sustain them against the odds, that subjectivities are worked and never immediately available. Experience is never something that just happens to you, but is worked in lives. One of the misunderstandings of this particular argument has been to glorify hybridity for its own sake. This is not news to anyone in this room. So that hybrid knowledges are supposed to be a particularly good thing. Now, since I've been guilty of propagating certain of these appalling ideas, it struck me as very important to sort out the difference between ideological hybrids and working hybrids. Between those kinds of hybrids that are power blind, that don't worry about what conditions of possibility for which kind of hybridization matter when, that don't have that kind of fine-grained attention to the ecologies of hybridity, on the one hand, and also those kinds of hybridities where nobody entering into them changes, where the kind of alliance of convenience, where everyone's view of the world is pretty much the same at the end of the day as it was at the beginning, where the hybridities are in a sense mechanical, versus those kinds of hybridities where an epistemological and ontological risk define the name of the game, where nobody truly is going to come out of this anywhere that they know about when they went into it. Those kinds of engagements, whether they're with the World Bank, or whether they're with an indigenous alliance organization, or whether they're with a community living wage group, or whether they're with your dog. Those kinds of ontological and epistemological risk, that the world and the subjects in it are not going to be the same at the end of the day because some kind of work needed to get done. And if some kind of work needed to get done, then no one's going to be the same at the end of the day. Now that's a very hard discipline. I actually think that issue is at the heart of the sort of post-structuralism that excited me. The post-structuralism that felt like home was the post-structuralism that was anti-libertarian and anti-liberal and very much about the working of subjects and the historical contingency of achievement and of putting things together that mattered. It was in that sense that I never felt the post-structuralism that mattered to me was in opposition to Nancy's feminist standpoint theory, for example. The various colleagues would say that we surely must hate each other and be in major opposition, because how could the language of standpoint theory, as Hartsock developed it, be compatible with the languages of situated knowledge or modest witness? I think it has everything to do with the particular understanding of working the world, worked subjectivities and worked knowledges, as opposed to a kind of epistemology of land ho, I have discovered my experience. Yet one more great voyage. So let's go to Vancouver Island and Clackwood Sound for some examples, an illustration of the points I'm trying to make. And let's do it in 1995, when a series of reports were issued by an entity called the Scientific Panel that had been struck by the provincial government in an effort to produce closure on searing conflicts in the forest that had resulted in fabulous protests in the forest in 1993. There are surely some people in this room who were arrested in those blockades. The kind of massive breakdown of any possibility of consensus. And of course, Canadians care about consensus in some contradistinction to the lower 48 particular states. The scientific panel report on forestry practices made the context of 125 separate recommendations that were accepted by all parties, itself a major miracle, by which I mean the tribal councils, the central region bands, the communities, the community councils in Tofino, the provincial government, the federal government, and others. An astonishing achievement of alliance around questions of knowledge that redefined what was at stake in forestry from industrial forestry and maintaining forest output to sustaining forest ecosystems. So that the important boundary object of contention switches in a real moment of warping the conditions of discourse that had been worked by many constituencies. The arguments from there are about what constitutes a sustainable forest community, and whether that sustainable forest community is going to be defined entirely in terms of the biologist's knowledge of ecosystems, or whether human communities are understood to be part of forest communities from the get-go, and if so, which human communities, and will the labor unions be ruled out of human community by a particular kind of fetishization of this thing called indigeneity, which itself, as you well know, is produced in the globalizing discourses of the 1980s, where the apparatuses of the production of global indigeneity is one of the mixed blessings of discursive work of the 1980s. Who's going to count as human? What's going to count as community? What's going to count as forest? What's going to count as ecosystem? The debate comes to be relocated in a very important and, I think, productive way. But far from producing closure, this report and everything that went along with it opened up a quite other set of struggles that I think have been particularly fruitful and interesting struggles. Even when, at least in the short term, failure seems to be frequent. Now, two things are required by the scientific panel report that are of interest to me. One of them is the joining of this thing called scientific ecology, ecosystem ecology, and this thing called traditional ecological knowledge, which of course comes equipped with its acronym, TEK, TEK. When traditional ecological knowledge got an acronym, I knew I was in a post-Reagan family. This was a very important little signifier. You know, I remembered my Marthian mythologie. You know, I understood what that acronym was doing, and the particular way that traditional ecological knowledge was a crafted holism that claimed a kind of timeless, that some of its spokespeople used to claim timeless authenticity, and others of its spokespeople used to do quite other kinds of work. Okay. Now, it is mandated in the scientific panel reports that all further studies of the forest system and the Clackwood Sound drainage basin area, five different drainage basins, that all further studies must involve putting ecosystem ecology and traditional ecological knowledge together. Now, I think this is something like a bad joke. So it's not a bad joke. It becomes an extremely interesting job. Okay? The second and co-determining premise of the report was that co-management is the name of the game, that all plans be they harvest plans or community development plans or what have you, have got to involve co-management. So the argument comes to be co-management from where, on whose terms? Does co-management, for example, involve the Central Regional Board or the Central Region Tribal Councils at the end of the day or in the beginning? In the beginning, who is the spokesperson for which groups? Again, who's excluded? Because the politics of exclusion have got to be faced head on. So is co-management going to be a kind of window dressing for business as usual, where sustainability comes to mean sustainability of harvest, after everyone knows there's been overcutting for decades? Or is sustainability going to mean economic restructuring, economic development, value-added industries in the region, various kinds of joint venture arrangements that are going to make everybody's purities and certainties break down so that Macmillan Bloedel Forest Company, and maybe even Interfor, though that's much less likely, you know, are going to be part of the alliance? What's going to happen when Greenpeace actually has to get in bed with Macmillan Bloedel instead of blockade? Where are different possibilities going to open up in working out these two seemingly innocent rhetorical announcements of the scientific panel reports? Well, let me finish by giving a couple of examples of where I think some very interesting encounters have occurred. But I want to preface it by a place where I think a very uninteresting encounter has occurred. It remains the case in written documents that are put out to describe what counts as so-called Western science, or sometimes called global natural science, or whatever, if you're trying to mute the Western bit. And remember that it was a global project from the get-go, and that the Chinese and the Arabs were into the game for a long time. And, you know, people who are conscious of that might not call it Western, but they're still going to describe the natural sciences, most often still, in terms of a kind of realist, a fairly stripped-down cartoon realist epistemology. Where the sciences develop through various processes of reductionism and modeling and quantification, various processes of purification that construct certain context-specific sorts of objectivity, which usually the context then drops out and is just called objectivity as such. That scientific knowledge relies on abstraction, modeling, quantification, objectivity, disengagement of subjects, and various kinds of realist rhetorical methods, various conventions of writing that emphasize the achievement of facticity and the achievement of various kinds of quantitative accuracy. And so-called indigenous knowledges, or knowledges of women, or knowledges of the marginalized, or knowledges of the stigmatized, or knowledges of the oppressed, fill in the blank. All of the above are supposed to be closer to embodiment, subjectivity, fleshliness, blood, usually blood, the various fluids and solids that connote suffering and death, and authenticity. So that if you actually read the stuff on traditional ecological knowledge, you will come up with an astonishing list that is holous, oral, close to the earth, You know the list by heart, you know the catechism. Now, if you actually get in some of the working groups, where let's say a project like the Long Beach Model Forest Research Project is attempting to develop research protocols for folks who come into the region who want to study, let's say, species interactions, and what's going to count as best science really matters. Okay. Now, is best science going to count as the sort of boutique science that the University of British Columbia from Vancouver is going to engage in, where they'll do essentially inventory science, in which they might very well consult with elders, nobody under 50 years of old, please. So what's going to count as the bearer of traditional ecological knowledge is going to be marked by a certain kind of fetishized elder status. Okay. And are they going to do a kind of quick and dirty, what I call boutique science, often unfranchised out, the little research corporations into the bargain. Okay. Very well-funded stuff, by the way. These folks are getting much more money than my brothers. And they're going to kind of hit and run science in terms of getting just enough data, just enough species to model just well enough to be able to say what kind of cut you can sustain, okay? Or what's going to constitute sustainability. But the work of actually building incommensurate knowledges into each other isn't done. Or are you going to do more like what Jim Darling with the Biosphere Research Project, people with Long Beach Model Forest research plans do? Which is talk about what kind of presence on the land, over what kind of length of time, what sorts of data collection protocols, what sorts of agendas are going to be built into the research plan, Are you building into the study of species interactions a deep historical sense of what might have been the human impact on land? And if so, how are you going to get those data? And who's going to get them back? What kind of report, you know, who's the report going to? And who's going to fund this? Now, part of the process of challenging business as usual in the forest has been stumpage fees, raised stumpage fees, put on ongoing harvest has actually created a nice little pot of money. So that funding new best science is not out of the question by a long shot. And struggling for what's going to count as best science really matters here. And I think it really matters to face the kinds of ideological ramifications we on the left have made of science, of indigeneity, of locality, of embodiment, of knowledge, to break down our own foolishness about the natural sciences so that we understand their cobbled together quality, that their negotiation at every level of the negotiations don't involve just humans, they involve machines, other organisms, histories of odd and heterogeneous kinds. That knowledges in the natural sciences are as cobbled together as anywhere else, but with their own specificities. And how do you make some of those specificities travel? How do we drop our own stupidity in representing what counts as the West in this little story, as well as dropping our stupidity about what counts as the marginalized or the oppressed, and put everybody at risk in a place where it's not safe to be at risk, because more of the shots are still called from what we could reliably call the center. Including large capital, for example, the recent economic crises have affected the forced economy of British Columbia in ways that have immediately impacted the very promising and fragile efforts to put together incommensurate knowledges that I and others have been tracking. By the way, most of what I know about this comes from a man named Gary Shaw, who's been deeply involved in trying to make a lot of this happen, who's been funneling me information nonstop. So I'll stop here, having affirmed the principle of privileging some knowledges over others, having affirmed the importance of hybridity in knowledges, but having also noticed my own and other people's stupidities about the way we reify these sorts of matters very quickly, out of our own discursive traditions and out of our own propaganda about who the enemy is, and the kind of ontological and epistemological risk that goes into making certain kinds of new alliances actually grow in the world.
Each in their own way, a very, very important and distinctive purchase on the world is something that we really have to think about. about very, very seriously. And this also gets me back, if you like, to think about some of the things that Nancy was talking about, which is talking about situated knowledges and how the situatedness generates certain understandings, but maybe obscures others, and how we might actually then think about certain privileges, or privileging certain kinds of knowledge versus others. Now, I want to nuance Nancy's argument, and to some degree Donna's argument, in two very specific ways. I have no problem at all coming out of this Marxist tradition with the idea of standpoints and situatedness of knowledge, and I have no difficulty at all with the idea that the bourgeoisie has every interest in, as it were, obscuring and masking the sources of its wealth and power, whereas, for example, the working class does not, and that therefore you're likely to get a superior kind of knowledge building out of a working class perspective than you're going to get out of neoclassical economics. If I can, excuse me, get my usual cut in. Now, this, so I have no problem with that, but then I want to think a little bit more about situation, location, standpoint. And you see, for me, they're very geographical terms. And being a geographer, I immediately jump, you see, and say, okay, you use these spatial metaphors. Let's now talk a little bit more about what exactly that might mean. And the first point I want to make is that standpoint, location, and situatedness, that they don't mean anything unless you also have some kind of map of the world in which you can talk about what that location means. Now, this is one of the things I learned from Nancy in a rather different language very early on, which is to say that there is always a relational definition of standpoint and situatedness. And it's not an absolute thing, it's a relational, an internal relation of some kind. And without knowing and thinking about what it's related to, you can't get very much further with what that knowledge is about. Let me give you just a very concrete example, in particular, this notion of knowledge at the margin. Well, where is the margin? What is our map? One of the things that brought us three together was that internally within Johns Hopkins, we were marginalized, dissident people who were trying to develop an alternative kind of knowledge. And from that standpoint, I could start to say, well, you know, I'm the oppressed one in this institution. We were all oppressed individuals in this institution. And there is a certain correctness, I think, to the argument that from that situatedness of oppression within the institution, certain kinds of new knowledges could be built and certain new insights could be gained. But if I extend my map outside the borders of the campus and went across the city and looked at what's happening right throughout the city, it would be ridiculous to maintain that I'm a marginalized kind of person. Absolutely ridiculous. So what looks like a margin in terms of one map of the world is not a margin from another map of the world. And so I think the first question I'd like really to sort of pose for all of us to think about is, what kind of map of the world do we have to express what our situatedness is? Cartoonist Steinberg died the other day, and you know the famous, you know, New York is map of the world, which has New Jersey, some little thing, and then everything else is kind of. We all have that kind of problem of defining our location. And so actually changing our map of the world, it is sometimes a very radical way in which to try to reread our situatedness. As I situated myself inside of the university and I then changed my map of the world to the city, I reread my situatedness into a completely different situation. So I think that question of the map of the world is important. But then there is also another particular difficulty, because there are different ways in which we can map the world. As a geographer, I always like to go back to the notion of a map, projection. I like the word projection because it captures all sorts of things. But the difficulty of creating a projection which is going to capture the world out there. And there are multiple map projections, thousands of them. And in a way, they're all true. It's just that they're using different criteria to be constructed. And I think this is a very useful analogy, because it says we have different projections on that world. And in this instance, I would want to make, I think, a very important point. The world is the world. And I think there is, perhaps, a case to be made that there is an essential truth about that world. But we can never know what that essential truth is about that world, because we can only construct projections. So there are all these different projections. And we then have to think about what the relationship is between them. You know, one kind of projection maintains direction accurately, but the areas are all wacko. Another maintains the areas accurately, but directions are all wacko. Some of the projections, as you know, sort of split the world up into little bits and pieces, so it looks like a peeled orange, and others make it sort of look like it's a squashed orange, and you know, I mean, they're just fantastic variations. But I think we live in the world all of the time of those multiple projections. But there is something common to them all. The first thing is they're trying to map the globe. And the second thing is there are certain principles about those map projections which you can actually use to define whether a particular projection is accurate or not. And those principles are, of course, mathematical. And you work through the mathematics and come up with a projection which has certain kinds of qualities. So our situatedness, I want to claim, is not only dependent upon the map we have of the world, but it's also dependent upon the particular projection we're using. And if I sort of slide from the actual fact of a map projection to loosening the term projection to mean all kinds of mental operations of various kinds, then I think you will better understand the general sense of what I'm trying to say. But the core mathematical relationship seems to me to be rather important. And here I want to talk about the way in which you can actually transfer or translate from one map projection to another. That is, if you've got the mathematics right, you can, in fact, figure out, it looks like this on this projection, I can now actually translate it immediately into another projection. And this brings me to what I also want to mention very briefly, which is something that Donna began to talk about, which is the whole kind of question of hybridity and how do we negotiate between different kinds of knowledges. And the particular plea I would like to make is to work with the idea of translation. This is the idea I'm trying to work with in my own institution. And the idea of translation from different knowledges, one into the other. And to try to work with certain principles of translation. And I have some comments from a very interesting book that I like a lot, James Boyd White, on Justice's translation. And one of the things he points out that is very, very exciting about the act of translation is he says, to attempt to translate is always to experience a failure at once radical and felicitous. Radical, for it throws into question our sense of ourselves, our languages, of others. Felicitous, for it releases us momentarily from the prison of our own ways of thinking and being. Let me put that in very concrete terms. Every time I get really mad at my situation in the university and I'm having a real fit of angst and I'm about to blow up, one of the things I like to do is to go walk around the city. And when I walk around the city, I say, Jesus, I don't know what it is to have a real rough life. And I come back kind of actually reclaiming some sense of, well, you know, this world that I'm living in with all of its tensions and all of its stupidities is absolutely ridiculous to get upset and worried about that when we really should be out there fighting for justice in the city, fighting for some sort of different order of life in the city, fighting for, say, a living wage or fighting for some sort of much more universal notion of justice. So it is indeed felicitous in that sense. But it also, I think, by changing the map of the world in that kind of way and thinking about our situatedness in this more flexible way, you start to think about the different ways in which knowledge gets constructed. So when I get really annoyed at my colleagues in engineering for not listening, I also have to start to think about how it is to be one of them, what it's like to be an engineer. And the very fact that you laugh kind of suggests, you know, that you have some difficulty at that particular point, and maybe some resistance even, but it's something which I think we have to do. But then White goes on to say that translation means confronting unbridgeable discontinuities between texts, between languages, and between people. And I think it's terribly important to maintain the idea that different knowledge structures, in a sense, do have those elements of unbridgeable discontinuities. And he says, as such, it has an ethical as well as an intellectual dimension. It recognizes the other, the engineer in my case, the composer of the original text, as a center of meaning apart from oneself. It requires one to discover both the value of the other's language and the limits of one's own. Good translation thus proceeds not by the motives of dominance and acquisition, but by respect. It is a word for a set of practices by which we learn to live with difference, with the fluidity of culture, and with the instability of the self. He then goes on to say something that is terribly important to me in my own situation, and I value it greatly. He says, we should not feel that respect for the other obliges us to erase ourselves or our culture, as if all value lay out there and none here. Now, this is something which is important to me politically, as it is in terms of my own work with the engineers. There's a tendency, particularly on the left now, to think that somehow or other value lies with somebody who's so far out there on the margin that the Zapatistas are going to rescue us. Or somehow or other, the ghost of Chico Mendez is going to sort of rise up out of the Amazon and conquer New York City. I mean, there is that kind of sense that somehow or other, the real value lies out there. And I think this point of saying, well, you know, we have to learn to value ourselves in a very core way, and learn, and in fact, to respect our own language. And this is also what White says: as the traditions of others are entitled to respect, despite their oddness to us, and sometimes despite their inhumanities, so too our own tradition is entitled to respect as well. Our task is to be distinctively ourselves in a world of others, to create a frame that includes both self and other, neither dominant, in an image of fundamental equality. Now, we know a great deal about the problematics of translation. We know a great deal about the power of the translator to determine what it is we see and hear and read. We can problematize this problem about the translation endlessly if we like, but I would like to suggest a little bit, I think, along the lines that Donna was suggesting, that the notion that somehow or other you can create a hybrid language which somehow or other just mixes everything up and everything will be okay seems to me to be fundamentally misplaced. But that we should recognize there are different knowledges doing different things with different maps of the world with different meanings, but we should also learn this art of translation. And in thinking through how to translate better, start to think about how to translate from one knowledge structure to another. And here there are various direct dimensions to translation. I'll just mention two. One is the kind of horizontal translation, which entails translations between somebody in the sciences and somebody in the humanities, or between one ethnic linguistic group and another. And then there are the vertical translations, whereby we take something that's very concrete and try to talk about its abstract qualities. And we start to enunciate, dare I call them, universals, universal principles. And that translation is also very important for political action, because unless you've got universals on your side, you're not going to get very far. And if, for example, I make claims in my own city about a living wage, and if I can connect that to some sort of notion about Universal Declaration of Human Rights, Articles 21 to 24, that says everybody should have a decent remuneration, then I've got arguments on my side. And I think one of the things that's happened is that we've been so concerned with particularity, so concerned with difference, that we've forgotten that other kind of translation whereby particularities and differences can be brought together in terms of some kind of universality. Which is not to say that universality exists independent of particularity. This is again something that I've learned about dialectics from people like we would be in a much better position to start to think about the diversity of knowledges as in fact an extraordinarily wonderful thing about human life, at the same time as it doesn't totally disempower us and make us incapable of some kind of political action. Thanks so much.
Okay, so we now have a chance to give these folks a breather, and those of you who can think about translating a question of yours into something that speaks to something that they have broached and put before us, please raise your hand, and Vicky and myself will try and track as many people as possible, and I can come and pass this mic around to those in the back who might not be able to be heard. So, has anyone got a question or a comment? It seems to me that one of the key things about translation also is making yourself vulnerable at some level.
Laboratories and the entire family of laboratories.
knowledge and gathering information on that, and then getting inside corporate science, for example, what kind of, to whom is which corporate science accountable and how? What time, what are the lines of accountability? Who determines research agendas? The question that Nancy asked about for whom, or at least are asked, for whose good, that the questions about both the beginnings and the ends of the knowledge really matter. And they matter in corporate science every bit as much as in, say, some community-based ecological research project. So I think one of the insights of science studies is precisely to break up the theology of the good and the bad, and where the angels and the devils lie in knowledge production, and there are many surprises out there. And that at every layer of the onion, the insistence that knowledge is made, not made up, and that getting at its apparatuses is what the science studies person is about. So that, again, St. David's example of the tying the campaign for a living wage to the United Nations Declaration of Human Rights and the specification of those rights over the last 50 years since the declaration. One is coming to understand exactly what it took to make and sustain a universal. That those universals weren't found, they were built at a particular moment of opportunity in post-World War II culture that part was instead of socialist versions of Putinese. There, as we all know, that the Declaration of Human Rights was, among other things, a Cold War document. Nonetheless, a universal was constructed that was very workable and remains worth sustaining for, among other things, tying up the campaign for a living wage. Similarly, scientific knowledge, whether they're produced out of the DuPont Research Laboratory or Xerox PARC or Microsoft Labs or the still barely public University of Washington, struggling for larger public spaces, struggling against the ongoing privatization of knowledge production, none of that answers, you know, what's going to count as good science in particular configurations.
One of my particular projects is working on the rhetoric of the environment. So I found what you've said, Professor Haraway, particularly interesting. But one of the things I'm struggling with is introducing the notion of ethics, which primarily is not only, not to offend anybody, fairly white, old folks and the stuff that's available. And even introducing the notion of ethics into science brings up the whole notion of tainting. Science.
You might
be called relevance. Yes. But I'm very interested in actually also reading the teaching of writing in terms of introducing ethics and coming at it not only from an ethical standpoint of the Greek notion of ethics, but other systems of knowledge that even introducing another system of ethical knowledge is suspicious because it smacks of indigenous knowledge, which is either romanticized or not taken seriously. And I just wondered what thoughts you might have.
Well, it's a very hard issue because, first of all, the philosophical tradition of ethical inquiry is part of an inherited discursive tradition. It does have, it kind of grew up someplace and not others, and it takes translation work to make it travel. And sometimes it's the wrong translation. Sometimes one is better off in, you know, a really important risk-taking encounter not translating that particular language, but maybe listening to someone else's language, for example, the one that was suggested a minute ago, for getting an inquiry going about whose lives are at stake how. You know, for whom and how is that change? What, that there are many discourses about well-being and the well-beingness of the entities in the world, human and not. And that I think we have inherited some very powerful tools out of the tradition of philosophical and political ethical inquiry. I'm not about to disown them or not deploy them. But I don't think they're always the right ones to translate. On the other hand, in terms of this, the discourse about natural scientific knowledge, I do think it is important work to insist on translating the arguments about ethics, about choice, not in the libertarian sense, but casting your lot, in some ways, in how you make those translations is hard, because it doesn't come down to being the people I liked did the science or came out with the answer I wanted. You know certain, which by the way are strategies various of us have taken at various moments, that there would be a women's science, what would that mean? Well, some people meant it to mean some things that I could never ever be comfortable with, and other people, many, most, struggled to make it learn, taking account of the consequences and values and insights of people situated historically in a certain way in relation to the knowledge projects that matter to them, and then doing the translation work.
I understand that all of you are arguing for the need of privileging some kind of knowledge, and I think that in fact as individuals we all do that, we all prefer some knowledge over others, whether we admit it or not. So my question then is, do you have ideas about a method or a process with which a community or a collective identity can decide upon which knowledges they are going to privilege? And is there, in fact, one method or process to do that, or does the process itself have to become a site of struggle and negotiation?
Well, I think that the process itself is something to be struggled for, and that is a really important thing. But I think one of the critical issues in privileging some knowledge over others is something that I think we're having a really hard time with here at the end of the 20th century, which is a vision of the world that we would like. That in some sense, one privileges the knowledge that in some sense is tied to that vision, that will enable people to live in a different way. But we can talk about, as Donna does, finite freedoms and the importance of developing some notions of justice. But I think one of the critical things in terms of privileging knowledge is certainly the issue of vision. I think a second important point is really the question of, so what are the things that you need to understand in order to make that vision happen? That is, what kinds of perspective do you need in order to see the workings of a social structure? And which knowledges can help you get that perspective? So I think that there are many things involved in it.
Yeah, I go along with that. I mean, it seems to me that many of these issues can't be debated independent of some notion of a political project. But if you try to debate these questions in abstract, you will go on forever and ever. Maybe that's why we academics like to go on forever and ever. But it does seem to me that some sense of a political project is absolutely vital to deciding over certain questions of what kinds of knowledges get privileged over what. Having said that, then there are the complex questions which we really haven't got into too much, which is the question of alliances across different kinds of knowledge structures. Because you know that if I have a particular political vision, then I have to actually sort of find myself with many others who have a political vision which is not quite the same as mine. And at that point, there is also a negotiation has to take place around the political vision itself as to what it is that you're trying to accomplish. And the point about this also is to say, life is always lived as a process, and we can't sort of ever be out of a situation where we're making key decisions where the privileging is going on all the time. So it seems to me that the personal point here is to recognize that we are privileging knowledges and privileging things in our daily decisions and our daily lives, and then to move, if you like, to the level that Nancy was talking about, which is to kind of say, well, what kind of collective vision can be constructed out of this? Is there a different collective vision for how the world will work, how our relationship to the environment will be, what kinds of social relations are we seeking to construct? And outside of those sorts of the negotiation, out of those, many of the questions about which is a privileged form of knowledge and which is not become sort of scholastic debates is to jump on a head of a pin kind of thing. And we won't really sit, be able to sit down and talk about something which is a much more constructive process. But it's going to have to be fought for. That process of negotiating out what are proper knowledges and what are proper knowledge structures, that they have to be fought for, and have to be fought for at all levels. And then internally within the university, it seems to me, there is a really major battle shaking up as to the nature of the kind of knowledge structures that are going to be there in the next century. And a lot of debate and discussion has to take place on that, and then people will come up and say, this is right and that's wrong. But at this point, we were also kind of saying, well, what kind of knowledge structures do we need for what kind of political project? Are we just simply going to create a knowledge structure which is okay for corporate capital? Are we going to create a knowledge structure that is just okay for sort of big government, big science, and big corporations to sort of cheerfully rule the world? Or are we going to try and create something that's much more democratic, much more open? I think part of the battle inside of the university is always going to be put in these abstract kinds of terms, when the real issue is very often about the nature of the political project that lies underneath.
Liberal, anti-racist, UN Declaration
there's a certain kind of real heavy stigmatization going on, a real apocalyptic and barely secularized devil narrative going on about who the enemy is. And I think the politics around a major source where wealth has been accumulated these days, mainly engineered genes, is particularly riven with these sorts of problems in terms of knowing who the good guys are to be allied in the first place, where trust is, and many, many, many levels.
My question comes from the story you were telling us about the forestry issues that you've been observing and the kind of breadth of knowledge that you hold from that process. And I was wondering first how you saw yourself as a participant, if at all, in that process. And then from that, in terms of alliances, what are the sort of tacit or tolerated capacities in which academics can participate as social activists in a certain sense in these dialogues that they're both observing, writing about, and then taking back to the academic community?
That hits right at the heart of one's anxieties, not one's anxieties. Because I am not a member of Friends of Clackamas Sound or, for that matter, an active member of Greenpeace, which has been a, I am not a stakeholder in terms of the organized participants in the Clackamas Sound dispute. And not because it would be impossible to do so. It's not like somehow others. And nonetheless, am a participant in other ways, in terms of networks of conversations that go on among the women who are Greenpeace activists, active women in this case, and in arguments with Richard Atleo about the way the New Challenge represents both indigenous and Western science. But in a sense, they're offstage arguments. And they're offstage arguments where I feel both obligated and guilty about deploying certain kinds of skills that I have because of the privilege of my own education, basically, and certain kinds of hybridity that are privileges of being able to deploy several knowledges. You know, the man of parts in the Renaissance was the elite person who could deploy many knowledges and many languages. And this is an ongoing dilemma of both of an ethical, political, and epistemological kind. But I think David's insight about not disowning what you know in these issues really matters, and that the last thing in the world, a speaker, an example, a person who was on our campus 2 weeks ago, a woman who is a biochemist and a member of the Lakota Sioux people and an opponent in the Human Genome Diversity Project efforts. The last thing in the world she needs is automatic agreement from a white feminist who all of a sudden disowns everything she knows. Or yet another version of that. Because the arguments are too important, too interesting, and the need to break down our various ideological starting points is very serious. And I think the ideological starting points around what science is, both in the science wars and I think the stupid remarks about post-structuralism that got made there, or on the part of the structuralists about standpoint theorists, or I think it really matters to take these ideological disputes, and academic people have a serious role to play in all of that, and that includes the forestry issues. But I haven't been able to publish on the subject.
Can I just a little gloss on that? Because that kind of question doesn't make me anxious at all. Donna is interested in. part of the question is how to translate those experiences as far as you can understand them and through inquiry and all the rest of it into, for example, a university setting in Johns Hopkins University where I can get people to think about this as a serious issue. So my job is really, you know, when we talk about these things, I see it as a translator. But not only a translator who's doing it in a passive way, because, you know, one of my favorite lines out of Marx is the question, who is going to educate the educated? And therefore, this is part of the process of self-education. Now, the fact is, I'm a lousy activist. I'm not a lousy activist. I'm a lousy community organizer. And so I kind of say to myself, well, you know, it's ridiculous for me to go out there and sort of try to sort of be, you know, right down there. What I'm good at is talking to people who are doing those kinds of things and trying to find a way to translate what they're saying onto a different plane of generality, both upward in more abstract terms, so that, you know, some of the big abstract thinkers in the universities might kind of get worried about it, you know, or more horizontally by sort of trying to get, say, a student group interested in this as a particular kind of problem. So it doesn't make me anxious in the sense that I might be doing something wrong or that there's something problematic. That sort of are, you know, epistemological issues and so on, which are attached to it, which, you know, you try to do the best you can with, and usually in some way or other you do screw up and you recognize that's going to happen to you. You're never a perfect translator. You're going to miss some things. You're going to, you know, and then somebody's going to say, hey, you missed that completely, and look what a bad job you did. In that case, you go back and start all over again. But I think positioning ourselves in that kind of way, or at least in my case, I would say, you know, I position myself in that kind of way, then it relieves some of the kind of anxiety that somehow or other I'm a bad person because I'm not out there, but, you know, I don't know, hugging the trees or standing in the trenches or standing in the pouring rain sort of holding hands with low-income workers as we try to pick a building or something. I mean, I sometimes do those things, but like I say, I'm not very good at that. So again, it's a matter of trying to situate yourself as part of a much more part of the general process.
It sounds like you're talking about maths. But I'd like to actually pick up on your notion of translation, because you make it sound too easy. If you screw up, someone tells you, and you say, oh yeah, which most people wouldn't do. But one of the things that I worry about in terms of translation is really this issue of incommensurable discourses, conflicting epistemologies. And one of the examples that's come up for me is an article by someone named Carol Cohen a number of years ago. She spent 6 months in a defense think tank, and she found that she had a lot of trouble getting through to the strategic planners with her concerns. And so she worked hard to learn their language, you know, to learn to talk about killing tanks rather than people, you know, collateral damage rather than killing civilians and so on. But what she found was that once she learned that language, she couldn't express her own concerns. So this issue of incommensurability, I think, is really difficult. And what you were talking about, Donna, in terms of bringing all of these different ways of thinking about the world into play.
And I think Carol Cohn's example is a good one of the person you turn out to be as a result of an act of translation may not be who you want to turn out. I certainly felt that in the course of professional life, having turned into many sorts of people about which I have a very mixed feeling in doing this kind of thing.
I'm glad you brought up part of the question on translation, because that's the question that I had. And I was wondering if there was a way to conceptualize translation and really problematize sense, like a work I read by a Japanese deconstructive kind of author who really problematizes the idea of what it is that we know as Japanese thought through the idea of translation and how the power of the translator and the unknowability of can open up like a huge, you know, abyss of unknowability. And then I was trying to think about that in terms of alliances. And if we maybe could think about alliances not in terms of somehow sameness or knowability or certainty, but in a more, I'd like to raise Professor Haraway of incommensurate knowledge. So I don't know, I'm trying to bring a bunch of pieces together, and I don't know if any of you can speak to what I'm trying to say, but I'm thinking of troubling translation to that extent and what that would mean for alliances.
Can I just jump in here? We all know sort of what you're talking about, and there are a lot of examples. One I came across recently is in Benedict Anderson's most recent book. He has a very interesting discussion of the English translation of the pioneering texts of Filipino national. Which were of course written in Spanish. And they've now been translated into English. But they've been translated, when he went through it, he found that they've been translated in such a way as to almost completely eliminate exactly what national consciousness was about in Jose Vidal's writing. And here you can clearly see how a certain act of translation has been profoundly misleading. But the point here is that Benedict Anderson is in a position to go back and excavate that kind of problem in much the same way that Edward Said did with Orientalism and so on. And I think that there are many, many cases where the power of the translator has been an abusive power. And I think, you know, that has to be, as it were, understood as part of what the problem is about. But having understood that doesn't mean that we give up on the idea of translation. And for me, the reason why translation still remains a very important idea is in spite of all of the abuses, in spite of some of the incommensurate abilities, in spite of the power relations, this is a way of having respect for each other while maintaining our differences. And it seems to me that that is the single most important issue for me, politically on the agenda, which is that I know the world is, you know, there's plenty of differentiation in the world, and we can all talk about what differentiates us up in the past. But we have also, if we're going to have any kind of political project, we're also going to have to talk about what it is we have in common, what it is we wish to do. And it seems to me at that point the notion of translation, which may indeed involve questions of trust, it may involve all kinds of other things, that we don't have anything else. And that this is a very important part of the jigsaw of how we come to some sort of notion of a common political project across multiple differences, but doing it in such a way that we don't suppress those differences. Because that seems to be the big problem. We have plenty of history of differences being suppressed in the name of some sort of unitary project, but what seems to me to be on the agenda right now is, yeah, we know what differentiates ourselves, let's accept all that differentiation, but let's think of certain ways in which we can put it together. Translation is therefore important to me, in spite of all the ways in which it can be problematized and all the difficulties which we know are there and all of the dangers which exist.
You know, one of the areas that's bothered me recently is also about knowledges that are not to be translated, knowledges that are owned and held in private. And now I'm not talking about corporate proprietary knowledges, but this comes out a lot of genome politics. Certainly there's been an issue anthropologists have struggled with for a very long time. And that is knowledges that come with lineages, or knowledges that come with peoples, or knowledges that come with place. Knowledges that are not to be brought into, that are not to be universalized, where the act of universalizing the itself is the fundamental gesture, no matter the intentions of the universalizer. And these knowledges turn out to be salient in a number of contemporary struggles and affect the nature of alliances. So I think, you know, I don't disagree with anything David said. in most of the situations in which we find ourselves working, but we also work within maps and projections of variously inaccessible, not simply untranslatable knowledges, and that whether to respect that inaccessibility or not matters. Whether you're talking about copyrights or whether you're talking about narratives being owned by families, and this has affected a lot of the sovereignty and land claims issues, the degree to which things have to be brought into public court in order to be established in law. Some of the Australian land sovereignty struggles involve this sort of issue. And the decision not to translate and to argue for proprietary knowledge, but notions of property that aren't John Locke's, it's not mixing labor with nature, that there are many modes of accessibility to knowledge, and that our toolkit for talking about it, nature and society, commercial and public, that we have very restricted, people like me, very restricted toolkits, and we think our categorical language is neutral, and the only problems are sort of figuring out what to do with the very language we're using to describe the problem itself isn't a problem. And we're using notions like nature and society or social analysis or politics, they're very much the problem. So how do you deploy these tools all the while knowing their tropes? And that the only thing you can say about language in principle is that you can't say what you mean because language doesn't allow you to do that. That the very nature of signification is about swerving. And simultaneously saying what you mean doesn't matter. It's that holding in real contradiction that doesn't resolve all these levels about translation of language, all of which has gotten me in a lot of trouble, friends and enemies.
I guess I just have an observation more than a question. I want to hear what you have to say. It seems like we're talking about the possibilities for new knowledges and the paying attention to the work that knowledge producers do and paying attention to the way in which knowledge production is a process and is active. And it seems to me that there's two places that we can address or that we can think about directly that haven't been addressed particularly but that have been alluded to. One is the closing down of certain possibilities for knowledge as being in the university due to the withdrawal of state funding from mostly public universities, but also strange public-private things like Johns Hopkins, which is more public than private, or used to be. And also in terms of pedagogical practices, in terms of the way in which in large universities such as this one, the lecture becomes the main way in which knowledge is not translated, but it seems that if it was working under the transmission of knowledge, that knowledge becomes instrumentalized and therefore becomes easily quantifiable, easily transferred, and therefore easily turned into a commodity that can be captured on a CD-ROM or something. So that we see certain assaults on the possibilities of new knowledges in those ways, and in ways that make alliances on campus is very important, and alliances between and among faculty and staff and graduate student assistants, as well as with the students to get the students to be in a more active role in terms of their learning. And I just invite your comments on those fronts.
Yeah, well, the pedagogical practices, I mean, I guess, maybe 15 or 20 years ago, there was a lot more attention being paid to that question than now. I don't know what's going on. And it seems to sort of come and go in waves. My sense of it is that, everything sort of slid back into some sort of almost standard package of what pedagogical practices are supposed to be about. And I think some sort of broader discussion on that is important, not only for the nature of the knowledge that gets produced, but how people might learn to maybe translate from one situation to another. I just thought you heard me some this week. I mean, we have a living wage campaign in Johns Hopkins, which has been very effective, and I think it's actually been one of the most marvelous teaching devices we've had, which is to have a political campaign on campus with real heft to with each other in and around this particular campaign, and I thought this was something, you know, somebody, one of the administrators kind of was complaining about it, and I said, well, I thought this was a wonderful pedagogical experiment, and that the university should encourage it, and in fact, they might want to fund one next year, you know. So, but the point is that we actually start to see this, these things in this very narrow kind of way, and I accept very much that actually the knowledge learning is the learning process is very important to understanding how those knowledges might get used and how they might get subsequently appropriated in the context in which those knowledges are learned, and what they're being learned for is also, you know, very important. And this also creates another dimension which is very important to me. You know, where we learn things from, including the literatures we appeal to and so on, is just as important in many ways as to sort of exactly what our situation is in society. As we can learn a critical perspective on ourselves by going into literatures which teach us things which we wouldn't otherwise know. And here, too, there is, it seems to me, insufficient attention being paid to the kind of diversification of learning things from different perspectives, so that at least people start to understand a way of translating from one field to another, just as a sort of micro kind of problem. And this, again, my impression is that there is not enough experimentation of that going on. In my own university, as you kind of commented, we sort of fall back into the fact that, well, there's a lecture and then there's a section and then you write the paper and that's it. You get your A or your B or your C, and then at the end of it, you've got your qualification, and you're out. You know, there's a sort of atmosphere of that sort, which is very distressing about university education. But then, here too, you come back to which power structures like people to think that way. And it doesn't seem to me that this sort of structure of educational experience is antagonistic to the perpetuation of certain kinds of modalities of power. And again, part of the struggle has to be about trying to change the pedagogical structure as well as the knowledge structure.
I'd like to add just a little bit, because I think one of the things that's really important in terms of creating knowledge, both in and outside universities, is in fact what goes on outside universities. I mean, David, you said a while ago that the really new and important questions tend to come from outside universities and then get
conversations about things like species or like universities or about foundations that cut across major historical and cultural differences simultaneously with understanding the irreducible historicity and contingency and the fallibility of that very tools of having that conversation. The most certainly the intervention of species, you know, principal among them, a really important inheritance. And one of the criticisms that's made against many of the biologists that I've watched, Parasite, that I know very much, one of the criticisms is that these folks care about species, but not peoples. So that the human species exists as individuals on the one hand and as the species on the other, but almost all other kinds of collectivities are relegated to the domain of merely the social. So the biological claims the individual and the species and leaves in the domain of the social communities or ethnicities or racial formations or nationalities or neighborhoods or genders even, although that's still tussled over whether he gets it, the social or the natural. Although all biologists work their salt now and drop the word sex from their vocabulary and refer only to gender, but they mean what they used to mean by sex. So the bacteria have genders. What they learned from us. So that in fact, which super categories prevail in certain struggles is itself a struggle. And I think I actually learned that from post-structuralists. I learned why it is that it's important to affirm certain kinds of historically located essentialisms from post-structuralists. And I think our conversations are why, but not because of the internecine wars that break down between foundationalists on the one hand and post-structuralists on the other. Almost making that
I'm afraid I have to block up the end of this conversation, but I really want to thank everyone for coming and for participating. And thank you. There is a reception outside for everyone who's here. You're all welcome to stay and join us.
That's what I find amusing. So I guess I do know what I'm struggling against in that sense, that consensus is a bad idea.
It's a nightmare.
Yeah, and if it does happen, then it's probably... And then when it does work, it's because people then exclude it, so to disagree with them.
Where's Sage? Sage? Do you have any... Oh, can you do another wink? How about with just one eye? Oh, that's pretty. How about with the other eye?
Yeah.
Well, just try.
The ones that actually thought they were getting some mistakes.
Two eyes.
It works better with two, right? I agree. So what do you think about this sort of activity here, all these large people?
I'm eating my chips.
You're eating your chips. This is more important. Have you noticed any interesting kneecaps? Sage?
I'm going to go home 3 days.
But have you noticed any interesting kneecaps among any of these people? Yeah? Who has the most interesting kneecaps?
I like school.
Oh, you do? All right.
Okay, so
that's all good. She wants to
get her family there.
He got a reprieve. He's going to have a life this weekend.